own. Ladies and gentlemen, now let's start with the first panel of the day. Is technology driving the future of CX? Companies that provide exceptional customer experience set themselves apart from the competition. Achieving this requires that a company think beyond just customer service. In fact, technology has given the consumer immense power when it comes to making purchasing decisions. It is estimated that by 2025, 95% of all customer interactions will be supported by AI technology and doesn't scare anybody anymore. On that note, ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together. Allow me to invite on stage Sunder Madakshira. He is the head of marketing Adobe on stage, who will be moderating the discussion along with our illustrious panelists. Ladies and gentlemen, a big round of applause. Welcome our moderator on stage. Allow me to introduce the panelists to you. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together. Welcome on stage Ritu Gupta, Director, Marketing, Consumer and Small Businesses, Dell India. Anika Agarwal, SVP and Head Marketing, Digital and Direct Sales. Right, I'm told Anika isn't around. Ritu isn't around. Yeah, I'm so sorry. I apologize. Ritu isn't around. So, ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for Anika Agarwal, SVP and Head Marketing, Digital and Direct Sales, Max Bupa. Deepika Sabharwal, Tewari, AVP Marketing, Tanishq. Srivats, TS, Vice President Marketing, Swiggy. Kashyap, Vadapalli, CMO, Pepperfry. Kishan, Kumar, Managing Partner, South, Wavemaker. And ladies and gentlemen, the panel is in session. Put your hands together for the moderator of the session, Sunder. Can I hear a big round of applause? Sunder, it's over to you.
So very ironically, Kashyap from Pepperfry is facing problems from sofa. So that's a great way to start. So great, guys. I think if you can find a more diverse panel than this, let me know. I'd definitely like to be a part of that. Five very different people coming from very different backgrounds, having worked with very different types of companies. All of them have, you know, we were just catching up. Absolutely colorful stories about customer experience and their own businesses. A lot of them are a big revelation for me, at least, and would love to bring some of that richness into our discussion. So the first thing I'd like to sort of kick off is the whole topic is about the technology is driving the future. Is that actually driving the future of consumer experience? But there's a promise I'd like to make before we start is that we will talk about the non-technology part of consumer experience as well. Now, that is a very, what shall I say, career-limiting question that I will put together because I am from Adobe. Okay, so let's start. So we got an interesting pair here. Anika Agarwal, who's bought a lot of gold, from Deepika, who sold a lot of gold. So she's a gold medalist in everything that she's done in her career. So over to you, Anika, with a question to all the panelists in sequence. How important is customer experience in your context? What is it that makes it business critical? Is it business critical? Are there parts of your journey which actually do not need that and you're still, you know, okay with it? So how critical is customer experience in your context?
So I think it's a rhetorical question, Sunder, but if you look at what we do as brand custodians, we create brand value. But finally, you know, when you deliver that brand value is through customer experience. So if you look at Max Bupa, for example, we sell health insurance. It's a promise. It's for a time when you fall sick. So it's not just the purchase of a product. It's a promise for future. And you know, the customer sometimes does not go to the hospital for 8 years, 10 years, and he still continues to pay you premiums every year. So what do you do with that consumer? He's trusting you. You've built that trust, but that promise is delivered through customer experience. And that customer experience is not just purchase. It's absolutely at every part of the journey. And when we talk about the non-technology part of it also plays a huge role for us when we talk about customer experience, because that's the time when the customer is in the hospital, for example.
Right.
So I think for us, customer experience is actually, you know, the sum of parts, and that whole actually has to be more than the part. So when we talk about customer experience and we think about it in our business, we don't just think touch points. So it's not just a touch point at the time of purchase or at the time of, you know, claim or renewing a policy, but it's the whole customer journey, and how that whole is bigger than, you know, parts is what defines customer experience.
Right. So I'll come back to you later with the kind of challenges that you're facing. How are you trying to interface digital and non-digital parts of it? But we'll park it for now. So over to you, Kashyap, in terms of, you know, Pepperfry. So tell us a little bit about the story of Pepperfry and how it's sort of evolved the customer experience journey.
Sure. So we, you know, started off 6 years back as an online marketplace for furniture. And we were trying to build a platform where a lot of Indian manufacturers from cities like Jodhpur, Saharanpur, etc., would be able to bring their, you know, products online. And we are trying to provide a platform for them. At the same time, we realized that even if you look at big cities like Mumbai or Bangalore or whatever, this is a category which is highly fragmented. You know, you do have a few brands, but all the large brands put together is less than 5-6% of the total market. You know, there is not really high quality information about this category. You know, I mean, for example, if I start talking about types of wood, types of designs, I think after 3-4 minutes, the average consumer who probably spends a few lakh rupees, you know, on furniture when they're doing up their home or when they're renovating it, their level of knowledge of what is quality, you know, what are the various types of design, it's all, you know, it's very superficial. And therefore, you know, there is a lot of people who trust a carpenter, or you're trusting a local store, or you're relying on, you know, the brand, a branded store if you're walking into it. So we figured that unlike, let's say, if you're in the mobile phones business or the t-shirts business or the, you know, selling shoes, there are really large brands. There is a lot of literature about, you know, product specifications, about, you know, this shoe is better than that shoe, or this phone is better, and that is a selfie phone, and this is a so-and-so phone. So there's a lot of knowledge that consumers have, but in this segment, that just didn't exist on the buyer side. And I think that reflected on the seller side, on the supply side. Really small manufacturers, really small mom-and-pop stores, absolutely no standardization of information, no standardization of material, no standardization of quality. So trying to build a platform in such a, you know, kind of a wild west jungle of a, you know, of a market, for us was very eye-opening. Okay, and we realized we can't, you know, we can't compete on price. We can't say, you know, this thing is worth $3,000, and you don't know whether it's great value for money. I mean, if I said it was $5,000, maybe you'd think, you know, maybe it's expensive. So you don't really have a great sense of knowledge. So for us to try and, you know, build a platform that, you know, provides the best price to customer, and we will compete only on money or value delivered, I mean, in terms of cost or price, that didn't make sense. When you think of, again, this category, it's very personal in terms of somebody may like a certain piece of furniture, somebody might not like it. There is so much variety, there is so much range across all these small manufacturers that I'm talking about that, again, you can't say, you know, I have the entire supply or I have everything that anybody might like. So while range and designs are very important, I think, again, that becomes very tenuous. And I think when we spoke to customers, when we first started out and we spoke to customers who were buying furniture from us, we figured that the biggest, you know, the biggest issue that consumers were facing when they were taking this decision is that there was a lot of anxiety. You know, typically a big occasion when people buy furniture and home decor products is when they make up their home. And, you know, they start that process with a lot of joy. There is, you know, this is our dream house. We will make it come alive like this. But when they get into the process, there is a lot of, it's not a smooth process in India. You trust a carpenter, you know, you think you can control the output, but, you know, often there are time overruns, there are cost overruns, there's the headache of the work happening within your own house, or you need to constantly be present to provide oversight for the control that you're seeking. If you go to a smaller store, you might get seemingly great prices, but you don't really get good designs. If you go to a large store, you're always afraid you're getting ripped off. So there's a lot of anxiety in the process, and that's the feedback that we got. So we figured that, you know, our job is to actually solve that bit. The customer experience in furnishing, I mean, putting furniture and furnishings and decor into your home in India is, it's painstaking, it's time-consuming, it's a very uncertain journey, and therefore consumers need a much more standardized experience. They need much more standardized information. They need more predictable behavior when they engage with, you know, this category. And I think for us, you know, that was really the aim that we set out to do. So typically, talking about, when you say disruption, you talk about, you know, upending or, you know, destroying an existing system. For us in this category, really the challenge or the mission that we have is actually to organize the system. You know, it's just the exact opposite of disruption. And that's really where we came in. And for us, we realized that because there are so many touch points and so much non-standardization, the customer experience in terms of just the overall process, being able to find something they like fast enough, being able to take an informed decision in terms of having a certain set of standard questions about materials, weight, dimensions, etc., and having a great standardized experience in terms of you know, the actual delivery and installation, which itself is a big event. I mean, you have to stay at home, or you have to schedule delivery at a certain time. You have to clear space in your house. A big sofa set is coming in. It needs to get assembled, installed. It's going to take 2-3 hours of your life. You know, it's a big event. And I think providing standardization, predictability in all of that was really what we were trying to solve for. The information, the decision making, and the actual physical experience. So for us, given that we just can't say, hey, this is, you know, 1999, please buy it, and it won't really sell. Or, you know, for us, really making the customers have a great experience, a confident experience in being able to find what they like, take an informed decision, and have a great post-transaction physical experience is really what we are trying to set up for. And that's really the base. So customer experience is really everything in what we're doing.
Right. So it reminds me of what our CEO just said 6 months back, that customers never buy products, but they buy experiences. So I think you're alluding to that. So from furniture over to food, Srivats, you have, he's from Swiggy. And so what's been your journey, and what's your real CX crux that you're looking at?
Yeah. So, from a Swiggy perspective, right? So I think the cornerstone on which we built our brand, our business, etc., has been consumer experience, right? And that's been like the cornerstone of what we've believed it from day one. And we genuinely believe that we have a set of 8 values within the organization that we kind of champion. And number one, first amongst equals, is consumer comes first, right? And so that's been our kind of guiding philosophy right through. And let me kind of exemplify that by talking about how we started. So we weren't the first entrant into the category of ordering in from restaurants around you, right? That's what we do. And we weren't the first in that category. But I think what we saw was that there was a clear gap from a customer experience perspective with respect to actually getting a great, reliable, convenient, hassle-free experience when you wanted to order from restaurants near you, around you. So back then, the category code from a, you know, from an infrastructure perspective was there's no need for a delivery fleet because it's going to be difficult to scale up a delivery fleet. It's going to be difficult to control, maintain, quality control, etc. But we actually felt that the only way we were going to be able to deliver a consumer experience that we were satisfied with and that consumers would be happy with was if we controlled the consumer experience from start to finish. So right from the time the consumer places the order on the app to the time he receives the food at his doorstep, right? And if you want to control the consumer experience end-to-end and provide a great experience, you needed to control the experience end-to-end. And that's why we invested right from the very beginning in a delivery fleet, which we own and we manage. And I think that has been our differentiator, the fact that we've actually managed to deliver a reliable, hassle-free experience from a consumer perspective. I know that before I joined Swiggy, I was definitely, I had heard about Swiggy through friends, etc. And I think word of mouth was a very strong driver of our brand, user base, etc. in the early stages. And word of mouth comes when you have great experience, right? So long story short, CX has been our backbone right from the very first day zero, day one. And it continues to be, our core driver for a lot of our initiatives, projects, experiments going forward. And we'll talk about that maybe a little bit more as we want.
Sure, sure. So over to you, Deepika, from Tanishq.
Both the earlier speakers are really digitally first companies. So I guess they are speaking about the tech-enabled CX experience. I think there are tech-enabled CX experiences and there are relationship experiences of consumers. Tanishq started 20 years ago, and we were the disruptor in the category. We were coming into a category where family jewelers were the final word when you bought jewelry. And I think our journey has only strengthened, and today we are the most dominant player in the market with the largest share of the organized market, if I can call it, one of the biggest players. And that, I think, is only thanks to the consumer experience that we have given our consumers. In a category where trust is very important, where loyalty runs through generations, to break that, I think what we have delivered is only because of the relationship each of our RSO shares with each of the consumers across the length and breadth of this country. One of the things that I always believe, and I think we always tell our retail staff, is it is okay if the consumer doesn't leave with a bag from the store, but it's very important that he leaves with a smile in his heart, because then he will certainly come back. The other point that we always feel is that in our category, there are two types of consumers broadly. One are the investment seekers, and the second are the adornment seekers. Tanishq really talks to the adornment seekers. And when you are buying jewelry for adornment, you're in the happiest moment of your life. Even if you're just buying a 2 gram worth of gold. At that time, I think we need to make her feel like she is the most important person in that shop in that moment. And I think that's what makes the consumer experience for her at a Tanishq store. That's really the touch and feel and the relationship part of Tanishq. As Tanishq moves to e-commerce and comes on with the online space, I think technology is playing a very good role in enabling us in that journey. But I think we'll talk about that a little later. But I think to the question of how important is consumer experience, I think in this day and age where the consumer is spoiled for choices, not within our category, but also from categories like in the holidaying and experiences, I think it is only consumer experience that will make consumers choose and prefer and consider brands. So because there's going to be product parity, there's going to be inter-category competition, and only if we up our game on relationship as well as tech consumer experience, are we really going to be able to hold on and build loyalty with our customers.
So before we go to Kishan, I just have to stop you and ask you one question. There are two types of customers, right? People who buy jewelry and people who pay for it. So sometime in the course of this panel discussion, you'll also like to share how do you make customer experience great for people who are paying for it as well.
Sure.
Right? So that's not meant to be a sexist question. Guys, I need some cheer from the men. I'm speaking for you.
Actually, as I will answer that question even now, there are more and more women who are buying jewelry for themselves than men who are buying jewelry for
anyone. No, that's a great, insight, because it was so hidden in my life so far that I never experienced it.
You know something, we only pretend that you all are gifting it to us. The decisions are already made.
Great. Fantastic.
Great.
So, over to Kishan.
Yeah, but I don't think there is a choice, right? I think the decision has already been made by consumers that my experience or the experience that you're going to give me is going to make or break brands. Because, I lead a media agency, and one of the advantages of working in a media agency is that you kind of get to see the spectrum of consumers, right? So we work with tea brands, with breakfast mix brands, with Myntra, which is an online digital first company. We work very closely with Tanishq. So there's different varied sort of consumer segments we work with, and our job is to kind of arrive at the right solution for the brand so that, you know, the business prospers, right? And over a period of the last few years, we have very, very clearly seen that, you know, the shift is clearly from outputs to outcome, and the shift from outputs to outcome is clearly centered around consumer experiences, and that is something which is the driving force, and it is not probably because you want it to be, but that's the reality of life. And that's why, because today, if you look at the consumers today, they are the most informed lot, they're the most difficult to please today, they are very, very finicky about what they want. And they have probably the most, you know, lethal weapon that they have, which is they have the voice to share their opinion. So any good experience or any bad experience can make or break businesses today. And I'm sure all of you would have seen this, that, you know, there's a very interesting experience that I personally had, because I am sure most of you can relate with it. There is Uber and Ola on your phone, and you kind of keep shifting between both, right? But at some point in time, one of them takes over because of the kind of experience that they provide. And also, there's a lot of tech background to it in terms of how the algorithm kind of understands you and the machine learning kicks in. But in spite of all of that, where there is that one bad experience that happens, and you kind of goes back to the choice, right, which was not there earlier. So consumers are brutal today. Consumers are and which is why I said that the good and the bad experience are equally important. And that's why we have seen that, you know, today it is all about managing that expectations before that expectation comes to you. So kind of preempting what consumer experience can be and what the best experience can be. And then how do we kind of work towards it so that, you know, there's a delight that happens. And then that delight kind of multiplies to get in more and more converts to it. So that's why it is most important. We don't have a choice today. So
absolutely. Yeah, so I think we've got a fair idea of each what has been the journey so far. But just to sort of flip it around and say, when you're looking at it, say, from the next 18 months or 24 months from now, what is your CX vision? What is your vision? Where do you want to take it from where you are? You've all given us how you've come here, what are you doing currently, and what have you achieved? But in the next 18 months or 24 months, just to put a time frame to it, what would be the different things that you have in mind? What would you like to achieve from your learning so far? And how do you want to take the journey forward? And then we'll come to the technology about how that's going to kind of thing. So over to you.
So I think if you look at the next two-year horizon, there are two key things that we think are very important. The first is standardization, and the second is making connections. So let me talk a little about both. I think standardization, to Deepika's point, we are a business where, you know, we are a brick-and-mortar business. We are not really a digital-first business. So if you look at our business, only about 15 to 20% of our customers are buying us digitally. 80% of our customers are still, because it's an advisory business, you go to a person, you want advice, it's relationship, it's advice, and a person is buying basis trust. So how do you really standardize across each of these touch points? Because there are a lot of people who will go digitally, look for you, you know, check opinions, but then finally go back to a person and buying. So standardization across all touch points, that's a key, you know, delivery agenda on CX for us. And the other is connectors and creating ecosystems. Because, you know, in large businesses now, we saw Pepperfry and Swiggy, what they're doing is that they're trying to control the entire experience. So right from production to, you know, the end delivery, you try and own everything. In certain businesses like ours, where you cannot control, you don't own the end experience. So in insurance, you actually go to a hospital, which is a separate provider. How do you really use customer experience? How do you create connectors? So what we are trying to do is create health ecosystems, for example. When a customer is going to a hospital, how do you use technology to ensure that, you know, your experience is what the customer gets there? And it's a combination of offline and online, right? So we have something called point of care desks in key hospitals. So when a customer goes, there is the brand experience that's being delivered by the brand there at the hospital, but also connector moments with the hospitals so that technology is used to seamlessly get customer reports, get customer discharges done faster, and so on. So standardization and creating these connections to a health ecosystem is what, you know, we are driving in health insurance.
Interesting, you use the word customer and not patients.
Absolutely.
Right? So there's more to it. We'll come to that because I had a very specific question on acquisition, so I'll come back to it.
So, you know, honestly, I think the entire customer experience piece, I don't think there are any milestones in it. I believe that, you know, as we tried to build the business, we figured what the customer's pain points are, and we are trying to solve it. It's obviously a work in progress. And then we are able to kind of move forward. So I don't know whether I can say, you know, we've reached so far and what the next 18 to 24 months are looking like. But if I were to look at, you know, just how we look at the various aspects of customer experience, let's say the first bit really is how customers interact with us. We started off as a web-only, platform. We later launched our app. After the app, we actually launched physical stores. So today we have about 32 physical stores across the country, across 11, 12 cities. They contribute to about 20-25% of our business. Obviously, all the business is still online, but we are able to tie back that a certain person walked into a store and then placed an order subsequently. So they're kind of giving that credit to the store, so to speak, because we think the store played a role in influencing their decision. You know, the first bit is really how do customers interact with us across all of these, touch points. And if I were to take, the thing that we are optimizing continuously is for the conversion funnel, really. I think that's one place where the consumer and the brand or the company are completely aligned. The consumer would like to, you know, when they hit a website, find something that they like really fast. Okay. And that's exactly what, you know, we also are trying to drive. For example, something that we are continuously trying to do is, furniture is not a very search-led category. You can't search for four-leg sofa, beige color and so on and so forth. You want to look at stuff, you want to feel inspired, you want to feel it, you want to like it, and therefore it's a very browse-led category. That's how we think about it. People see a lot of images. We provide like between 8 to 12 images per item. There's obviously the opportunity to rotate it. There's opportunity to zoom in and out. We are implementing, solutions where you can literally see it in 3D. On our mobile phone, you can already actually, select items. Not all items, but select items. Turn on your camera and see how it looks in your room. So we are trying to kind of fine-tune the way customers are able to find something that they like. So that's the process that's going on continuously. For us, getting to a position where we are able to utilize our entire library into an AR/VR kind of an environment where customers are able to experience the product in kind of 3D depending upon the technology available, whether it's from tech available on the mobiles or through centers, like we already have 3D centers. And if we can actually get it into a VR area, we can actually, expand that to 100-200 really fast. So that's something that we're trying to do so that customers can come in, really find what they like to see, be confident about the decision that they're taking, and so on. So that's just one example. Something that we already do, for example, is, when you're a very browse-led site, you have tons of images for every product, and people need to browse. And imagine buying on the mobile phone. Today, 40% of our business happens on the mobile phone. 20% happens on stores. 40% happens on the mobile phone. People are buying dining sets and sofa sets. And we know pretty much that, there hasn't been a touch point on the web for them. Their entire touch point started and ended on the mobile phone. And
So people are able to take those decisions. So just how quickly you load images, okay? How quickly they're able to swipe through those images. For example, that's where technology plays a big role in helping us to kind of optimize the conversion funnel. People are able to find what they like to see, all aspects of personalization, all aspects of using data to drive people down a certain path, all of those things come in. So that's one area, finding things. And the second area is really post-transaction. So for, I talked about earlier where, you know, there are two aspects to the physical touch points that happens to consumers. You get somebody who delivers. There's a delivery team that delivers the item, and there's a separate installation team. What we do is, today, for example, you know, the delivery team, as soon as the delivery is done, they have a handheld where they indicate that, you know, the delivery is completed. And then immediately there is a bunch of, there's a network of carpenters on bikes across the city who will, carpenters on the bike across the city who would then get to know that this particular delivery is done, and we are able to, you know, almost like an Uber or a Yula, we are able to, or Ola, we are able to kind of give the closest carpenter the job so that they can go in and do it. So that's another place where technology comes in. Just, I think, like I said, it's a continuous process. We are trying to solve problems as they keep cropping up and trying to keep fine-tuning it. So I think that's really our continuous path.
Sure. Thanks.
So from a CX vision perspective, right, 18 months out, et cetera, there are two parts to it. One part of it is we have this concept of a perfect order. But on the other hand, we know even now there are a set of consumers, there are a set of orders every day that are not perfect orders, right? That those are bad orders, whether it's an edit from a dish perspective or a cancellation at a restaurant or a consumer-initiated cancellation, right? So that's a certain number. Our goal is to get that to something approaching near zero, right? So out of every 100 orders, we are at a certain bad orders, whether it's whatever that number is, and we want to get that to zero. So at, in an ideal world, every order is a perfect order, where the consumer knows what he's getting perfectly, right? And there's no silver bullet, right? There is no magic that will automatically get this to zero. I actually think the way we think about it is, it's hundreds of different things done where you chip away at every single point to kind of bring it down over a period of time, right? We're a three-sided marketplace. There's the consumer side, there's the delivery executive side, and there's the restaurant side. So you need to chip away at each of these things at each, you know, at each side of the marketplace, working with restaurants to make sure that, you know, we're able to predict their prep times and wait times and things like that in a very deterministic way. Working with the delivery executives to make sure that when they're delivering a great experience, when they're interfacing with consumers, they're delivering the experience that we want them to deliver. And obviously working with consumers to kind of figure out what are the technology interventions that we can do to kind of make it all great, right? So that's one part of it, zero bad orders. The other part of it is basically addressing gaps in the market. So for example, the number of restaurants that we have in India is less than the number of restaurants in Beijing alone. Yeah, so supply side gaps exist in our nation, and therefore, how do we have this concept of Swiggy Access, where we work with the well-known popular restaurant brands to provide them infrastructure in areas that they're not present in, and thereby solving a consumer need where there's a cuisine gap or a, you know, gap. So I think these are some of the things that we're thinking about. Solve the gaps from a consumer perspective, as well as make every single experience a perfect experience.
Sure.
We have 220 stores across India, some of which are company stores, some of which are franchisee stores. And I think the continuing mandate on consumer experience would sum it up in 3 points. One is standardization. Second is regionalization, which is a contradiction to standardization, and I'll explain it in a bit. And the third is integration of the digital and the physical world. When I say standardization, I mean every Tanishq consumer across the 220 stores, and still counting because we will be continuing to open more stores even this year, should have the same Tanishq experience right from the time they enter the store to the time they bill and they walk out of the store, and the kind of experience that they carry back with them.
So that's one experience, that's one area that we are working on. The second area that we are working on is regionalization, because jewelry buying, a lot of it is still for wedding buying, still a very V purchase. It is with the family, with the mother, with the regional nuances, and therefore understanding what the Kasumala means down south, and what a Mangalsutra means in the west, and what a Lachihar means in the north, is very, very important at that moment when she's buying that jewelry. So how can we become more and more regionalized, especially when we're doing wedding trousseaux? Because at that time, which ceremony, what is an important custom, and therefore what is the appropriate jewelry to be bought, are nuances that each and everyone needs to know across the country. The third journey, because we started as not the digital first brand, but we are moving rapidly into digital, is how do we make the experience, the same Tanishq experience that they are getting with the Tanishq warmth and the Tanishq trust and the Tanishqness, the Tanishq way of life, how do we transform that into the digital world is the third big journey that we are, taking, you know. And so these are the three big points that we will be working on in the next couple of years.
Anybody has problems in standardization, you know whom to go to, and standardization and regionalization, that was very
Tanishq
important.
Seems to be your favorite.
Absolutely. I want you on my side.
Listen to Karthik, who spoke some time back. He said that, you know, consumers are polygamous. Retention costs are probably higher than, you know, acquisition costs. And the purchase journey has become so complicated over the last so many years that it is imperative to understand the purchase journey. So we kind of help brands to give that enhanced consumer experience by our obsession on purchase journey. Right, so if you understand the purchase journey the best, and we talked about priming bias, and priming bias is about having your brand in my consideration set even before trying to get into the category, and the higher the priming bias, the greater is the conversion rate. So how do we kind of create experiences in a manner in which more and more people are influenced to have more and more priming bias? So everything then revolves around our understanding of the purchase journey. So I'll give you a simple example. How many of you have actually used, and I'm also using this specific product because he's also going to be a keynote speaker. The person who I'm going to talk about, the brand I'm going to talk about, the founder of that brand is going to be a keynote speaker here. How many of you actually use the Vada, ID Vada Maker? How many of you have used? I can see a lot of brands, right? A lot of people have actually used it. To me, it's an amazing example of great consumer experience to somebody. So if you actually decode the purchase journey, and then now just decoding what would have been the purchase journey, right? So let's say I'm a single person living in Bangalore, and I really want a snack at the evening time, and I'm not a great cook, and I want something to be very convenient, but I also would want something to be very traditional, but I don't want to go through this whole pain of making a vada because it's messy and I don't know how to make it the way it's normally made at home. But here is a product which can make the vada in its true glory, like my mom or my grandmom used to do, in just 5 minutes time. And it's amazing, right? And that's where I think the consumer experience is at its best, right? It's a simple product, and we can talk about great other brands like tech brands and stuff like that, but here is a brand where actually, so that is where it is. So if you understand the purchase journey and kind of understand the insight, then you can actually create consumer experience. So that's one of the things which the obsession with the purchase journey, to understand those triggers, those small nuances which can create great consumer experiences. The other two things which I would probably want to leave behind is, one is, how do we create personalization? And the second is, how do we create that element of surprise? Now, personalization, consumer experience is all about me, giving me that experience and making me feel that important, right? So which is why the personalization becomes important. So when Myntra does its famous end of reason sale, we actually try to create more than 100,000 personalized creatives that makes you feel special so that you go back and kind of purchase on Myntra, right? Personalization is actually a very very interesting story which we had done for a very not so sophisticated brand, it's a tea brand, and it was in rural UP where we had data with us which said that, you know, the, and this is Tata Tea, they had just finished this famous Jagore campaign, Power of 49, and we had data across the country in terms of what are the specific issues by constituencies across the country of what women felt, right? So in UP, where we wanted to actually create a campaign, we knew that in group UP in Gorakhpur, the women in Gorakhpur actually felt that eve teasing, black marketing, these are the kind of issues that they were facing, and not the larger issues like safety and all of that, and empowerment and all of that. So we created a campaign which is using that insight to give a very, very personalized sort of a campaign using mobile and content. And that's something that personalization can do today, right? The second is, the other point which I, which we try to advise brands and which we do is that bring that element of surprise. In the consumer experience journey, if we can be ahead of the consumer, it will be always helpful. So if you can create an element of surprise, then it will be great consumer experience. And I'll give you an example of, for example, we had this, we are doing this campaign for one of the brands, one of the FMCG brands again, that, you know, normally FMCG brands are purchased off shelf. It's a very boring experience. You go there and there are multiple brands on the shelf, and there is no exciting experience when you actually purchase, right? What we did was, using technology, we created a shelf that talks back to you. And imagine if you add your favorite film star's voice, which talks back to you. The same film star who has been endorsing the brand on air now comes and talks to you when you are actually walking through the aisle and saying, hey. And imagine if you add some of his famous dialogues and some of those nuances and kind of, you know, actually our data proves that the purchase actually went up by X percentage by just doing that small little extra element of surprise. We had done a very interesting one for Tanishq some time back, where we had this diamond campaign where they had Amitabh and Jaya, and there was a wonderful creative and all of that, and we wanted to educate men about buying diamond, because the TV show was all about Amitabh getting educated about cut clarity and all of that. So we did a very different thing, where we actually, the TVC had a necklace of which he had purchased for Jaya. We said, let's do a detection game where the necklace was stolen. And Amitabh needs your help to find out who actually stole that necklace. And there was this 5 suspects lined up from the shoot studio till where he, where from Tanishq store till the shoot, yeah, where he, where we were going. And there was this, the store manager and the security guy and the dubbing, the chaiwala in the dubbing and all of that. And we worked with the creative agency Low to create this amazing sort of an element of surprise, which was great. And consume, and in the process we kind of educated them, saying why this necklace is important, because I had gone through so much of pain to buy this one because of the cut clarity, blah blah blah, all of that. So that element of surprise, in an otherwise, you know, we won't think you can create an element of surprise like that. So these are the things, and then the final is to do it consistently, because if you see Indigo as a brand, if you see that there is a certain amount of consistency across whatever they do, right? Whether it's the ramp that you kind of, you know, walk and get into the flight, to each and every small material that they do. So how do you kind of bring that consistency, right? The personalization, and today the challenge is you have to make it mass personalization. It's not just personalization for few, but it has to be mass personalization. That's where I think technology has a role to play. But personalization, element of surprise, and kind of do it consistently with, yeah, an obsession to purchase journey is something which I think.
Sure. So I'll take one. Just
want to say one thing.
Sure.
The next time you want a vada at 5 o'clock. You can always rely on Swiggy to get
it. Yeah. So, you know, one last question, and then we take questions from the audience. Quickly, within a minute, probably. If you could summarize the biggest challenge that you're facing in your customer experience journey, what would that be? And how do you think technology is sort of chipping in them? So, yeah, you could start with anybody. You can start with Srivats, maybe.
The biggest challenge. So, to us, one of the things that we kind of strive to understand when a consumer first opens the app, right, is what's his mood and what does he want. Ultimately, we want to manage, we want to understand, is the consumer there to make a quick choice? Does he know what's on his mind? Is he just there to place an order? Or is he in an exploratory mood? Does he want suggestions from us? So figuring out what the mood of the consumer is and what he wants, and personalizing, like Kishan mentioned, personalizing the experience to be relevant to every single user, every single time he opens the app, that's one big challenge. And we think that's the, like, that's the magic of, you know, perfect CX. And the other piece that we kind of think about, you know, in terms of building, etc., like I mentioned earlier, is how do we get, you know, how do we manage efficiencies with CX? Because ultimately, you can be very high on CX and very low on efficiency, and vice versa, right? So I think that is a, that is something that all brands will grapple with. For example, if our delivery times were to increase by 10 minutes, we would be twice as efficient. But there's a difference between a 35-minute delivery and a 45-minute delivery, right? So grappling between the trade-off and how do we optimize for efficiencies while optimizing for CX, I think is the biggest challenge that faces us.
I think very well said. Over to you, Deepika.
So as far as we are concerned, I think the reason we had the vision of the standardization and regionalization and integration is because those are the challenges that we are really facing, and that is why we are focusing on it. So I'll spend some time on the integration of digital and physical. If you look at it, consumers world over, the e-commerce part of jewelry buying is very, very, it's a very small portion. In India, if you look at it, it's not more than 900 crores out of a 300,000 crore market. So I think the biggest challenge being market leaders is how do we start working on the consumer experience and getting consumer more confident and enable them to buy online and jewelry online, because that will give an exponential delta to the entire category and bring in a whole lot of new consumers. So things like, you know, getting virtual try-ons and convincing consumers it's a good thing to buy, doing things like endless aisles. We are also very expensive raw material category, so you can't keep stocking up all the time. So therefore, having an endless aisle that showcases as many regional products and as many relevant products to a customer and multiple ways for them to then make choices. If you look at it, CAD-enabled customization and personalization, because there are there are many types of Indians. There's one mass India that wants to buy everything that everybody has, and there's some kind of India that wants to buy things that only they have. And therefore, how do you get personalization with CAD-enabled designs? Because you can't make a piece, and I'm sure that's equally relevant to Pepperfry, and then sell, destroy it if you don't like it, because it's very expensive raw material. And therefore, how do you do CAD-enabled design? And therefore, that's where integration of tech comes in into our the challenges that we are trying to face. And I think going on, reaching out to the consumer, building on what Kishan said, I think we need to do a million creatives for a million Indians, because there are how many castes and communities and subcastes, and each of them have their own jewelry nuances. So telling, if we really want to be India's largest, most loved jeweler and really win over those many million hearts, I think reaching out to them and telling them, hey, this is the piece that's really made for you and for your culture and you, and every part of India, is another challenge that we face. So these are the challenges that we are really facing in consumer experience.
Anika?
So I think if you look at it from our perspective, creating this whole ecosystem has been a big challenge for us and continues to be, on how do you really get you know, the pair, the providers and all the other service providers and the customers on the same platform and give them a seamless customer experience. So that's, I think, the biggest success factor and also the biggest challenge for us currently.
Honestly, I think points that both Srivats and Deepika made are absolutely things that we keep thinking about also. We have 32 stores, people walk into the stores, between 30 to 40% of them convert at 4 to 5x the average order value that happens online. Okay, online conversions in a category like furniture are under 2%. Okay, even when I look at unique customers over a month, etc., and do it, it's not, doesn't go up much more than 3-4%. So obviously there is this big gap between, you know, 3-4% on one side to 30 to 40% on the other side. There's a big gap between X to, you know, 4X, 3-4X in terms of order value. And therefore, being able to make customers feel more confident on the online, on the app and on the web, build confidence for them is the big thing that we are looking at solving. Some of the examples that I talked about earlier, improving the fidelity of the images, providing an AR/VR experience is one of the things that we're doing in that direction. But I think, it goes back to this whole point that Deepika was making about the whole online-offline integration. We know what it can be offline. We obviously are an online-first brand, so bridging that gap is something that we are working towards too also. Even today, if you order furniture, we have only 3 large warehouses, okay? Actually, right now, too, the third one in Bangalore is getting built. So most of our furniture for across the country gets shipped from either Mumbai or Delhi, okay? And Jodhpur is our source warehouse for a lot of stuff. So it still takes time. It still takes 15 days, 20 days. Customers get anxious during this period. And it's, again, a matter of resources. We can build multiple warehouses. We can store things closer to market. We can reach people faster. But, again, balancing out the customer experience with the cost is the second thing that we're working on, similar to what Srivats had mentioned. There, it's a matter of hours and minutes. For us, it's a question of days because the items are much larger, etc. So I think those would be a couple of big things that we're looking at.
So to me, the fundamental challenge is how do we get into the minds of the consumers, right? How do you understand the consumers and what do they want and all of that? And I think to a large extent, data can help that. And to add to that is a lot of mindset challenges that we have. Like we assume a lot of things, and a lot of it is based on the legacy way of doing things and stuff like that. Probably more so with not in digital first, but still there are a lot of assumptions. For example, we were working for this brand. We were doing a research on one of these brands, one of the watch brands, mass watch brand, and SSC BC, NCCS BC audience, and kind of assumed that, oh, you look to Instagram, to be Suna Yoga and all of that. And that guy told 4 things, how to use lens and this and that and the other, and how to use Instagram. And all. So there is a lot of this assumption that goes behind, and there is a lot of these mindset challenges. But so that is the one set of challenge. And the other is, how do we understand and get into the minds of the consumers and understand exactly what they want? Then only personalization can happen and all of that. And there is where this whole challenge of man versus the machine, the jugalbandi, how do we kind of do this jugalbandi, right? This a machine can tell you a lot of things, and increasingly it's going to be that. But the next panel, which is going to talk about emotions and all of that, is where the man thing comes in, right? This whole balancing act which Srivats talked about, this whole jugalbandi between man and machine, how do we kind of do that? Of the efficiency versus that challenge. Also, there is also this challenge of this now versus the slightly future long term. So there's this interesting quote that Bill Gates said that, we kind of, overestimate the next 2 years and kind of underestimate the next 10 years, right? So we kind of say, everybody talks about AI and EA and O and all of that, and kind of overestimate the next 2 years, but somewhere we kind of don't do enough justice to the, so this whole balancing of, for example, voice, right? Today, let's say you can say, Alexa, book me a cab. We can actually book, because Ola is Alexa enabled or whatever, right? But maybe less than 0.5% may be using it, or maybe even lesser. But we know that it is going to be behavior maybe 2 years down the line, 3 years down the line, 5 years down the line. We don't know. How do we get ready? And when do we get ready? And when do we kind of do it? Is the other challenge. So
right.
This whole, there are a lot of these balancing challenges which are there.
Sure.
So, So
fantastic. So with that, I'll open it up for a short question and answer session. Over to the audience.
Hi.
Can you get the mic?
Yeah. Can I ask a question?
Yes, please.
Yeah. So, from a customer experience point, let me state that I'm a huge fan of Amazon because I believe they have the best customer experience. And to be asking the questions, I was a Pepperfry customer. I am in between becoming between a Swiggy and a Zomato customer. I almost became a Max Bupa customer. I'm also associated with Tanishq quite some time back. So my first question, first thing is, let me congratulate Anika on that particular insight where you are trying to control the entire ecosystem. Because recently I had an experience where I had a very horrid time talking to the insurance team because there was the hospital involved in between. I almost gave up on that. So congratulations on that. From Pepperfry's point of view, again, I was a Pepperfry customer because I had a bad experience during the installation. So the question to you is, what are your thoughts on IKEA tying up with Urban Club for the installation, which is primarily from a customer experience from Indian context? From a Swiggy's point of view, again, had a bad experience recently where customer care kind of ruined the whole experience for me. As a customer, when you order from Swiggy, you are hungry. But then when the rider goes to the restaurant and then figures out that the restaurant is not active, you get a customer call, again, half an hour is already lost, and again, my hunger is growing up. I shout at the customer care, but again, there's no response. So then what are you doing to actually fix that particular problem? And at large, to anyone who can answer this question, we are still trying to, as brands or businesses, we are trying to figure out the online journey versus offline journey, whereas digital is kind of influencing majority of the purchases today. So then, what are your thoughts on that and how do you try to address that? Even in fact, Anika as well as Deepika actually said, online is only so much, offline is so large, but then it doesn't matter anymore whether it is purchasing from an online perspective or an offline. As long as I'm able to influence the customer anywhere, it should make, do the trick. So yeah, that's my few
like
questions.
A customer grievance plus, you know, digital.
No, so from a customer experience point of view.
Yeah, so we'll quickly get the answers from.
Thank you for that essay that you just conducted. Like I mentioned maybe a short while back, I'll keep this brief because I know we're kind of running short of time. We know that we have X percentage of bad orders. It's very low and it's an industry best, but we know that there is a bad experience that's out there, right? One out of X, right? And it's our objective to make sure that that one bad order or that X bad orders out of every 100 become zero. And we're not at 100% right now, right? So you are clearly amongst that X who's had one bad order. So using technology solutions, using like ramping up our CX force, ramping up our customer care, training them, there are hundreds of things that go into trying to make sure that you don't have that bad experience. But feel free to connect and let's make sure that you don't encounter that issue anymore.
So, like I said, we are 6 years old. When we first started this journey, I think many people were facing a lot of issues in terms of delivery, timelines being missed, and so things being broken, things not being installed properly, people not having tools to fix things. It's obviously been a journey. I think we've come a long distance, but we are far from perfect. Putting together a carpenter desk, putting together a delivery boy environment, and managing and running it in large cities with all the issues, it is a tough challenge, but I think it's an absolutely important challenge for us to crack 100%. We probably are not there. There could be gaps. There are gaps, and we are trying to fix it continuously. I think anybody who tries to do a business which involves a lot of physical labor distributed across the country in terms of managing standards and timelines and efficiency and quality will face challenges, and I think it's relentless focus in terms of how well you get it done, whether it is us or anybody else. We obviously recognize it's very important for us. We run a very aggressive NPS collection program. It's also painful sometimes. But we get about 20 to 25% people participating in our NPS programs. All the detractors, we try to follow up with calls to try and identify where we are going wrong. It's a continuous process. We are able to pinpoint studio level, delivery boy level, carpenter boy level, warehouse level, product group level, merchant level issues. Continuously repairing it, and it will be there as we expand our network, as we onboard new merchants. It's a learning process. If you had a bad experience with the installation, I'm sorry for that. But like I said, it's a learning process, and we'll try and keep fixing things as we go along.
Thanks so much. I think that's what the one pending question. So a lot of people are asking questions, but I'm afraid that's all time we have. Most happy to connect offline with you immediately after the session. So thanks to all the panelists, and there's no time for a detailed summary, but I think we got a very, very good and very wide perspective about the challenges that each one of us are facing in our businesses. So as I say, customer experience is about math and the magic. The math is about the technology stuff that you used, and all of you alluded to different technologies and different challenges you're facing. We'll get to the magic part of it, which is all about the emotion, in our next panel discussion. So thanks, you've been a fantastic panel, and big round of applause to everybody on this. And thanks for giving me the opportunity to moderate it. Thank you so much.
Thank you. All right, ladies and gentlemen, can I hear a big round of applause for all the panelists, please? Kindly stay back. We've got some mementos to be given away. To do the honors, ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together. Welcome on stage, Shaila Wajid, Business Head South, Wickedon. Can I hear a big round of applause for her? All right, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for your applause. Thank you, Shaila, for coming on stage doing the honors. Ladies and gentlemen, if you've seen the mementos on stage, time for you to win some goodies. I've got an exciting announcement out here to make right now. All right, ladies and gentlemen, this section is brought to you by 9X Jalwa, the channel which brings to you the best of Bollywood songs. 1990s ke zamane se 2000s ke zamane tak, har zamane ke behtareen gaane. So ladies and gentlemen, we'll be playing short musical notes. You'll have to guess the name of the song, and you'll tell the name of the movie as well. Alright, before we go on and play you those sound bites, ladies and gentlemen, we'll have a group photograph with the members of the panel. Can the panelists please come back again? Okay, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much.